So today we will start a very long chapter of herbivory. Last time we talked about parasitism as one type of ecological interactions. Today it will be plant herbivore relationships, and it will continue next lecture as well. There are two aspects as to any ecological relationship, and that is the purely ecological and also evolutionary phylogenetical. So we will be starting with ecology viewpoint and then moving to the phylogenetical one. Of course, with ecology nowadays, you always have to have a phylogenetic perspective on everything. Before we start, we can classify all these different ecological negative interactions. We had parasitism last time. So when we look at sort of conceptually at these interactions, then we have several categories. We have grazers. That means one individual negatively impacts many others. So that's fitting definition of many herbivores. When we look about animal-plant interactions, also flower nectar robbers, for instance, from animal-animal interactions, it could be, for instance, blood-sucking insects. Then we go to predators, where typically one predator kills many individuals. So not affects, but kills. So that has, again, consequences for population dynamics. And of course, lots of carnivores. But when we are talking about plant herbivore interactions, then also seed predators are fitting into this category, because they are also killing entire plants, although in the seed stage. Then we have parasites. Again, one parasite impacts one individual. That also applies to some parasitic plants. And finally, parasitoids. That's we already discussed last time. One parasitoid kills one individual, typically. Okay, so when we go back to our main topic of herbivory, we can start with very, very obvious, but rarely asked questions, and that is, why is the world green? We have a lot of plant biomass around here, and so we can rightly ask, why is that? You know, how is it possible that the herbivores don't eat everything? And so there are principally two questions, two answers, and then one is that some other trophic level controls herbivores. So although there is a lot of resources, lots of food, lots of plant biomass, then they can't simply finish it, because there is never enough herbivores, and that's because they are controlled from top down. That means that the higher trophic levels, parasites, predators. We can also look at the control of herbivores from bottom up. That means from their food resources, from plants. And that means that will be the case where we see a lot of greenery, but it's actually not edible, although it might seem to be so. So that means, you know, world is green, but the greens taste awful. And so we will explore which of these two explanations is more close to the real situation. And then we can also ask a related question. Yes, the world can be green, but how certain plants and certain ecosystems manage to accumulate much higher biomass than others. Again, this is very remarkable when we compare it with marine ecosystems, where typically marine ecosystems can have high production, but there is also high primary production is matched by high consumption. And so the standing biomass of primary producers is low. So that would correspond to highly grazed systems, or for instance, a golf course where the grasses can have quite substantial production, but the standing biomass is minimum. This is, however, not the typical situation. The world is not covered in golf courses, at least not for now. And the most typical ecosystems are forests, which are, of course, typical by a huge biomass accumulation. So again, we need to ask, it's not self, you know, it's not self-evident, it's not obvious. We could have had a very different world where plants would still be primary producers, but will be immediately grazed. And so there would be very little standing biomass. Before we go to the current ecosystems, we should realize that this plant herbivore interaction is ancient. Not surprisingly, herbivores appeared very shortly after the first even non-vascular plants, and then they were developing different lifestyles and different ways of exploit plants. So already from the fossil record, we can recognize leaf eating and galling herbivores more than 300 million years old. Then miners came a bit later. We have also pollen and nectar consumption, of course, with the flowering plants. And then there are further evolutionary improvements, including more specialized active pollination and so on. And then, of course, that all actually happened before the huge diversification and increase of angiosperms, which created current present-day ecosystems during the last 100 million years. Now, when we look at the herbivores, we have basically two very distinct groups. One is vertebrates, which tend to be grazers, tend to be low specialized and sort of general feeders. And then insects, which on the contrary, tend to be relatively host specific and also hugely species diverse. So it's the most species-rich herbivore group is by far insects. And also, when you look at insects, then within insects, herbivores represent a very significant part of the species. So you have different major orders here, and the herbivores are in green. So Lepidoptera, almost completely herbivores, and then followed by beetles, which are actually minority herbivores, but they are such a huge, hugely diverse order that they are close second. And then we have some others here. This kind of balance of herbivores and other feeding modes in insects can actually change because as a result of recent mass DNA barcoding of insects, because we are discovering that we know better herbivores than many other lifestyles for insects. And there is especially huge undescribed diversity of very tiny parasitoid hymenopterans, and also mostly sarcophages Diptera. So these were always neglected because hymenoptera parasitoids were too small and sarcophages Diptera were too boring. And so they were always selectively ignored by entomologists. And now with barcoding, we are realizing that they might actually be hugely diverse. Okay, now when we look at the plant defense strategies, the plants have several options how to handle herbivores as their enemies. They can be resistant or sensitive. And of course, if they are sensitive, they are likely to die. If they are resistant, then that can be because they avoid somehow herbivores or they tolerate it. And the avoidance of herbivores or avoidance of feeding by herbivores can be by escaping them, hiding from them somewhere in time or space, or actively defending themselves. And tolerance means that, yes, there can be a very significant herbivory, but actually the production of new biomass by plants is such that the herbivory can be tolerated. That it's actually sometimes, and we will discuss that, it's actually beneficial to to tolerate certain damage than invest huge resources into perfect defense. Okay, so what kind of defenses there are? Well, first line of defense is already that the plant physiology works in very different way than animal physiology, and therefore the plant body has very unfavorable composition when it comes to nutrition of animals, especially the low percentage of nitrogen, simply because the structural features of plants are large carbohydrate polymers, and so the amount of proteins and other nitrogen-rich building blocks is relatively small to what animals need, including herbivores. There are different levels of nitrogen in different plant parts, and the extreme is xylem set. That is basically water coming through xylem from roots to transpiration. And so whatever is there is more like leaking. It's a leakage in the plant plumbing, you know, coming from the nearby phloem. And so xylem sap is extremely low concentrated for nutrients in generally, including nitrogen. And despite that, there are actually specialists only feeding on xylem sap, but very rare. It probably originated between 1 and 3 times in evolution only. And there are very, very significant ecophysiological adaptations coming with xylem sap. For instance, the insect feeding on xylem sap, these are typically sap-sucking insects which are feeding on xylem sap, they have to pump and process huge volumes of xylem sap to extract whatever they need in terms of nitrogen and also sugars. Perhaps the most well-known insects which are feeding on xylem are cicadas. And you know, they larvae feeding on roots have very slow development, and they have to pump huge numbers of xylem volume. Cercopids, that's plant hopper family, are also relatively well known. They are protected from predators by this kind of foam, as you can see here, for when they are in larval stage. So there are some of them which you might notice on the vegetation, and that foam is easy to produce simply because of the huge, again, volume of xylem sap which they process. It's energetically problematic for them because they have to actively pump xylem sap from the plant. Okay, when we go to phloem sap, that's completely different situation. Phloem sap is under positive pressure. So it's really like if you have a water pipe, when you know, you drill into water pipe, the water comes out, and the same goes with phloem sap. So that's all what aphids, for instance, which is the best known group specializing on phloem, needs to do. They just need to tap the phloem sap, and then they have a steady stream of very sugar-rich, fluid, because phloem, of course, distributes the products of photosynthesis. So it's highly rich in sugars, but still low in nitrogen. And that's why, again, aphids, for instance, process large volumes, not as big as xylem sap insects, but then they excrete still sugar-rich liquid, and that is a basis of their mutualism with ants, because ants will take it as a source of energy. So in order for aphids to get enough nitrogen, they have super abundance of sugars, and that's why they excrete them. So these are very specific adaptations to these extreme sources of living on plants. And then we have leaves and seeds, which are still an order of magnitude lower than animals, at least in their nitrogen content, but it's already levels which which are more manageable. So for instance, when we look at how insects are doing on different quality of leaves, this is an example of such a space between leaf water fresh weight and nitrogen content. And we see that both are important. There is also positive correlation between them. The individual feeding experiments from different species are here in this as these numbers. And so we can see that the growth rate in different shades of the caterpillars is optimum at a high level of water combined with high level of nitrogen.
Super.
Okay. So now we have, as I already mentioned, it's not only ecophysiological variations of too poor quality of plants, but also all kinds of interspecific interactions which help to improve the quality of the plant food. So, for instance, hemipteran insects, including aphids, have endosymbionts, which are actually obligatory, and they are housed in a specific body organ, which is called mycetocyte, and they are actually helping to digest plant matter and produce nitrogen-rich, filter nitrogen and produce nitrogen-rich nitrogen-rich source for the aphids. If you cure, these are bacteria, so you can actually cure the aphid by antibiotics, and that cure will result in aphids dying. These are obligatory mutualists. There are also similar mutualisms with fungi, some of the cestidomid flies, and then there are more famous interactions between, for instance, termites and protozoa. Termites are digesting another extreme source of plant food, and that is dead wood. And so again, that's extremely low nutrient and also high cellulose content. And interestingly, insects or other herbivores can't actually digest cellulose, which is sort of counterintuitive, because cellulose is a polysaccharide. And so basically, if you chop a big cellulose molecule into the original sugars, then here you have a source of energy, and bacteria and protozoa can do that, but not insects or vertebrates. And that's why both insects and vertebrates have these mutualisms with termites. Different lineages of termites are working either with protozoans or bacteria. And so in this case, you can see a protozoa in the guts of termites, which again is decomposing cellulose for termites. And likewise, we have a similar relationship between ambrosia bark beetles and fungi. They are growing fungi in the galleries and in the trees, and actually feeding on these fungi, not on the wood itself. Okay, now once somehow the herbivores overcome these challenges of the actual nutrient composition of plant matter, then there is another line of defense, and that is the chemical compounds, which are actually synthesized either partly or exclusively as defense against herbivores. There are two ecologically different groups of them, which we can call quantitative and qualitative. Quantitative are basically big molecules, which often have also other roles, for instance, building the plant structure. So that's already mentioned, cellulose, also lignin. And these are typically very efficient, because they are simply slowing down the digestion, the feeding. You know, if you have a high cellulose content, then insects can't really do much unless it's the specialized one with the endosymbionts for that. The same goes with lignin. However, they also are very costly to synthesize, and once you have them, they are huge molecules. So you can't move them around, in between different parts of the plant. Then qualitative are basically small molecules which are poisonous. Again, plants invented all kinds of poisons. Some of them are very successfully used by people as well. For instance, amygdalin, that's a cyanogenic glycoside, so that leads to cyanide, and so very effective poison. Nicotine is an example of a huge group of alkaloids, and again, nicotine was originally invented by plants as a defense against insects, and it actually works that way, but can of course have other use by people. Actually, lots of or big part of what interests us in plants, from spices, from chili peppers to different drugs, is actually originally defense against either pathogens or herbivores. Of course, in the evolutionary race, insects have counterattack. They can respond to these poisons by actually altering their metabolic pathway so that they become resistant to them, and actually even using them to defend themselves. And so this is example from Asclepias herbivores. Asclepiaceae are full of cardenolides, which are again poisons, and insects actually can, feeding on them, can sequester them, reaching significant concentrations in their bodies, and then protects them against their predators or parasitoids. And that protection, of course, especially against predators, only works if the predators will recognize that this is unpalatable insect and will avoid it. And so that's why they typically have aposematic warning coloration. As you can see here, this is example of insects feeding on different parts of Asclepias, and you can see that they all can sequester to different degree. So there are two Heteroptera, two bugs, Tetraopis and Labinomera, feeding on seeds, which have especially high concentration, and then others feeding on leaves, and you can see that the concentration can match or exceed those on the original plant. So when we summarize this sort of dichotomy, it's partly artificial, of course, but we can simplify it like that. Then quantitative ones: cellulose, hemicellulose, lignins, tannins, silica, large molecules, immobile, costly to produce, effective only in large doses, and therefore they are present in long-lived tissues as a significant energetic investment which can be moved, and they are present in plants which are long-living, again long-time investment, and effective against most of herbivores, while qualitative compounds are the opposite. They are typically alkaloids, but also some toxic amino acids, cyanogens, glucosinolates, terpenoids, small toxic molecules, mobile, relatively cheap to produce, effective in small doses. These are all advantages, but effective against generalists, but it's relatively easy to develop tolerance. That's a little bit like our defense against bacteria with antibiotics. Then again, we have problems with resistance, and the same happens in the interaction between herbivores and plants. And these qualitative defenses, as we will see, are also mostly present in growing tissues, where first quantitative large molecules can't actually go to growing tissues, because if you have a growing expanding leaf, it has to remain soft and be able to grow. If you pump it full of cellulose and lignins, tannins, then you will basically solidify it and there will be no leaf expansion. So that's why especially these tissues are protected by qualitative defense. There is also biological defense. This is an example of such a defense which evolved remarkably convergently at least three times. This is the ant plants, where ants are guarding the plant against herbivores and are being fed by plant in a reward, and also provided housing benefits. So Cecropia in South America has hollow stems ready for ant nests of Azteca ants, which are specialized, and the plant produces glycogen-rich bodies which the ants feed, and then protects it from herbivores, but also from vines and climbers. So then in New Guinea, we have endospermum, again, hollow twigs and trunk for Camponotus ants. It's actually complete with the entry holes on the stem, and then extraflora nectaris feeding the Camponotus ants. And Makaranga in Southeast Asia, the nesting sites are below stipules, and it's for tiny Crematocaster ants, again, fed with food bodies. Other defenses are also mechanical. That's of course works against herbivores, against vertebrate herbivores. We will see that young leaves are especially valuable and worth of protection. And here you can see that the density of spines is extraordinary there. And as the leaf expands, then basically the spines stay in place and get farther from one another. Latex. Latex is a combination of mechanical and toxic defense. It's poisonous. It has the small molecules of secondary metabolites, but also it solidifies on the contact with air, and so it works like glue, gluing mandibles of insects especially. So it's also a physical obstacle, and of course we are using that as a natural rubber. So that's coming from originally, again, defense against herbivores. Again, insects can fight that. This is a sequence of action by chrysomelid beetle on the latex plant, so-called trenching, where the plants have lactiferous in leaves, and so these will deliver latex especially to the place where the leaf is being eaten, because once you damage the leaf tissue, then the latex will flow from neighboring parts of the leaves there. That is prevented by insects actually cutting the lactiferous around in a circle, and then happily eating the disc of the tissue, which only contains the latex which was originally there, but there is no way how external one can flow in. The production of secondary metabolites is costly, and so it's not always a good strategy for plants to actually produce them. So this is an example, one of very many we can show that this is a Cecropia tropical plant, which is actually adapted to fast growth, but despite that, it's producing tannins. And this is a simple study looking at the production of new leaves against the concentration of tannins. This is intraspecific variability of individual plants, and there is a negative correlation. At the same time, you can do lots of similar experiments about how these concentrations of metabolites act on insects. And this is the leaf fiber content, so that's again a quantitative defense and how it works on the host plant for the mortality of caterpillars of this geometrid Operoptera brumata, very common pest in the temperate zone. And you can see that there was almost perfect correlation for it. So the plants are really faced with the sort of necessity to develop strategies where they have to, evolutionary speaking, consider the likelihood of herbivory, how damaging is that herbivory, and how costly it is to defend against it. And so that will decide whether they will go rather for tolerating herbivory or defending against it. We also have to consider that typically the worst enemies of plants are other plants, not herbivores. And so it also depends on in what competitive environment the plants are in terms of they necessity to fight against their plant competitors. So this is an interesting study. Again, chilies are hot because of capsaicin and related compounds. And again, it's not for culinary pleasure, but it's meant originally as a defense against herbivores. But then even without human selection, there are naturally chilies which are hot and which are not really so hot. So the level of capsaicin is different intraspecifically. And this is study on one such species in South America, Capsicum chacoense, where there is a clear rainfall gradient in how well defended they are. So the white one have high concentration of capsaicin, and as you can see, are in rainy regions. And then there is a gradient to strong representation of low capsaicin, poorly defended ones in the dry area. So when you put this map into correlation, you can see it very clearly. And so there was an experiment where they showed that when you look at the seed production, which is a good measure of potential plant fitness, the seed production per plant, then when the plants were well watered, then there was no cost of creating capsaicin. So both what they call pungent, which means high capsaicin content plants and low capsaicin content plants were producing seeds at the same rate. But in the dry water stress condition, suddenly the low capsaicin ones were doing significantly better than those with capsaicin. And so especially in the presence of low herbivory, it might be actually beneficial to invest into seed production rather than defense. We have already mentioned different plant strategies, so we can come back to this classification. There could be in the resource-rich environment, there could be high investment in growth and low defense and low in defense. While in the low one in the resource-poor environment for plants, it's more typical low investment in growth and high in defense. That sounds sort of counterintuitive. You know, if you have a lot of resources, then why would you not invest some of them into herbivore defense? Well, that goes back to the fact that these high resource environments are actually the most competitive between plants. And so what is really important to invest in fast growth. And also if the fast growth is possible, then it's easier to compensate for herbivory and tolerate it. While the situation is much quite the opposite in resource poor environment. So in high resource environment, the plants can have the tolerance to herbivory, and that is necessity for those plants which are so-called apparent and not well defended. Apparent plants are those which can be found easily by herbivores, while unapparent plants are unpredictable in space and time, so herbivores have a difficulty tracking them down, so even they are not defended, they will escape herbivory. So unapparent plants, it's actually quite difficult, especially to hide from insect herbivores. It's almost impossible in the tropics, because there herbivores tend to have insect herbivores tend to have constant overlapping generations, 5 to 6 a year typically, and so there are always insects present. There is no seasonality typically, and they can they can colonize plants very quickly and typically exploit them before the plant can produce seeds. So that is combined also with the fact that a majority of plants in the tropics are either slowly growing epiphytes or woody plants, and these have real difficulties. But in a temperate zone, we can have some examples. For instance, you have specialized plants which have a seed bank in submerged sediments of you know lakes or in Budějovice and surrounding landscape. It's of course fish ponds, which is sort of a simulation of this kind of wetlands, which where the water fluctuates, and not only because of the pond management, but in the past it was also naturally, and so you can have very unpredictably exposed these bottoms of the stagnant water, and so the plants in the seed bank can start growing. And these early stages are typically annual plants, which will grow, produce seeds very quickly, and you know the whole generation is out. They will supply seeds to seed bank and most likely will never grow there again next year, because either the water will be back, or even if not, then more permanent grasses will invade and outcompete them. So that's actually a genuine example of a strategy where you can have a landscape mosaic of single generations of these plants appearing very unpredictably, and with insects having only one or two generations in temperate zone, they can have real difficulty of tracking these plants. While when you look at the margins of fish ponds, Phragmites, that's an example of a very stable, predictable, steady vegetation there, which is reliably there every you know and producing new leaves attractive to herbivores every spring. Okay, there are also some suggestions that even longer living plants can be rare and part of the mixed vegetation, which tends to make a search by herbivores less efficient. So there is a very simple experiment where they were looking at cucumber plants planted in different situations, high density monoculture, low density monoculture, polyculture mixed with corn and cabbage, either in low density or high density, and they were looking at the response of specialized herbivore, this beetle, feeding on cucumber plants. Once you know how fast it was able to colonize individual plants, and they found that yes, the monocultures were more conspicuous, even if you had the same number of individual plants actually as in the polycultures. That's sort of not extremely surprising result, but again, it seems to be fairly difficult for longer living plants to be so rare that they will efficiently escape searching herbivores, especially insects. I think lots of these theories are sort of underestimating the ability of herbivores to find the plants. Although there are some consideration also on interspecific level, whether it might work. For instance, there is an interesting phenomenon. We know that insects typically increase the diversity towards the tropics, but there are several interesting exceptions. And one of them are aphids. You know, aphids are really major part of herbivores and herbivorous communities in temperate zone, but they are almost absent in the tropics. And so when you express the number of plant species per 1,000 square kilometers in different regions against the number of aphid species per plant species, then there is on the per plant basis the low diversity, floristically low diversity areas have many more aphids relative to high diversity, which means tropics, and it's quite a consistent trend. While it doesn't work that way in butterflies, for instance. In butterflies, you can see that the per plant diversity is pretty much constant. So that means, yes, there are more butterflies in the tropics, but it's mostly because there are more plants. It's a very trivial relationship. And so there are some explanations. Aphids are very hard to explain because they are so different from other insect taxa in many levels. So this is example where, you know, if you have something happening to an evolutionary unique group, you have a statistically sample size equals one, and so whatever explanation you come with, then there is no other group to test it. So this is a bit problematic, but one of the explanation might be that aphids, which the host specific aphids can have a very hard time to finding their host plant because they are terrible. They actually, as insects go, they are really terrible at finding host plants. They are basically lifted by air currents and they are sort of floating about the vegetation, and then they sort of can go to the landing by, you know, actively flying, but just with the air currents, they can't really fly very efficiently and land exactly where they want, like butterflies do. And that's why this is one of the possible explanations. Now, another interesting defense of plants against herbivores is predator saturation. So it's actually opposite of trying to be unapparent. It's being produced in such a huge numbers that it overwhelms the herbivores, and therefore high percentage of produced seeds in this case will survive. So this is actually a common strategy in temperate zone trees, even in orchards. When we grow our fruits, apples, and so on, we know that there are very good years and there are bad years for the fruits, and the same goes for natural ecosystems. So this is example of a corn production, and you can see that it fluctuates by huge range of values. And then when you look at the seed years, which high production, then the percentage of acorns attacked by the principal galler, which is this fly, is actually negatively correlated with the acorn production. So in the years where there is a little production, a high percentage, up to 80% are destroyed by this fly, and that goes as low as 20% in really good years. This sort of makes sense. It's a dilution of the existing population of herbivore, but it only works if the herbivores can't build their population over time. So that means the saturation has to be unsteady population, which fluctuates a lot, so that after a good year, you can have a really poor year. So all these insects which successfully increase their population size will again die out, and the population level will go low. So then next seed year, there will be again difficulty for catching up with increased resources by plants. The same will work for vertebrates and the seed predators there. This is another such example. The large larix, and again another seed predator, another fly, and again hyeras have low percentage of attack. Okay, as we already mentioned, the especially early successional plants, which have to really compete to establish themselves in a really fight for light with other plants, often use the strategy of tolerating herbivory. So in this high resource tree gaps and other early successional stages, we can often see the high herbivory and low level of defense. So there is a meta-analysis of the factors which are connected with herbivory, and there are some correlations. There is a negative correlation with leaf lifetime. So the longer living leaves, the less herbivory, which again might look counterintuitive, because you can argue that the long leaf is a steady resource which can accumulate a lot of herbivory damage, but these leaves are typically quantitatively protected. These are long-term investment by plants, so they are more heavily protected, and so there is the longer leaf lifespan, the lower herbivory. Then less surprising is the defenses, which have effect different to different degree. And then there is a positive connection with nutrients. Again, of course, the plants, the more they are attractive, because they have high level of nutrients, the stronger attack by herbivores. But also the connection that these are plants in this high resource environment which have to grow fast. And so when we look at this is the study of the plant growth rate, yeah, and so these herbivory, actually there is a paradox that the herbivory has positive effect on the growth rate. So you can say that the higher herbivory, the faster the plants grow. And of course, the underlying mechanism is that we have this gradient between long living leaves, heavily defended and slowly growing in low resource environment, as opposed to this high nutrient, fast growing, heavily competing against other plants, which can tolerate herbivory to high degree and actually have the herbivory to high degree. Even in these plants, herbivory is still costly. It's not that you know, there are no costs. Like this is example of such a fast-growing tropical shrub, piper, and the production of seeds against different levels of herbivory individual plants suffer. And yes, there is of course a negative correlation. Now, when we go to the opposite extreme of this spectrum, we can see epiphytes, for instance, are at the really extreme spectrum, because they are in one of the lowest resource environment. You know, they are out of the connection with soil, apart from some suspended soil in the tree crowns, and so these are extremely slow growing. At the same time, there is not much competition between one epiphyte shading over another one, simply because everybody is growing extremely slow. There is no nutrients, and therefore the biomass is extremely valuable. You know, if you have a lot of money and you lose, I don't know, $50, it's of course less problem compared to the situation when it's your last $50. And so these low biomass and low growing plants have to protect their capital, their biomass capital, much more than fast growing pioneers. And that's actually what's happening. When you look at three big groups of epiphytes, ferns, orchids, and bromeliads, this is Tillandsia, that's one of the bromeliads, then this is the leaf area missing, and it's actually only ferns which are eaten to a certain degree. But these are number of plants examined, so you can see there were hundreds of orchids, and pretty much nothing was eaten. And the same goes for bromeliads. In Papua New Guinea, where we had our survey of the herbivory, then we had looked at hundreds of orchids. This is actually Orchid House. The tropical orchids are almost exclusively epiphytes as opposed to the temperate zone ones. And so these are different orchids, and we pretty much saw no herbivores at all. So that means also that the perfect defense of plants from herbivores is actually possible. You know, it's only a matter of decision, evolutionary speaking, whether it's wise decision or not. So all this discussion about the gradients goes back to so-called leaf economic spectrum, which is sort of one-dimensional suite of correlated traits where plants go from slow to fast return on the investment into building of the leaf. That's Joe Wright published that. And it's based on a lot of correlations between different leaf traits, which can be sort of all put into one direction. So it's either positively or negatively correlated, all these ecophysiologically important factors. So we have leaf mass per area. So that's how heavily and how well is the leaf built. Leaf lifespan, we have already mentioned that. And that goes with photosynthetic capacity, respiration, leaf nitrogen, and phosphorus. So these are the fast-growing, nutrient-rich plants with high herbivory, and these are the ones like epiphytes with extremely low herbivory. Okay, so that's one of the big topics, and now we are still staying with herbivores, but we go to slightly different approaches, which involve another trophic level, and this is the induced defenses. So far we have been talking about defenses expecting that the plant defends itself as it grows, and you know, basically there are some decisions done for the plant for its entire life, but it's not necessarily like that. There can be also induced defenses, which are more flexibly responding to the actual herbivorous pressure. This sounds sensible, and there is a lot of evidence that plants can be very flexible. So, for instance, this is a well-studied system of birch Betula pubescens, and the geometry morph Epirita autumnata from Northern Europe, and there are several measures of how the caterpillars are doing on the leaves, the weight of the pupa, which high of course is good, the development period of larvae, which the long one is bad, high survival is good, and the egg production of resulting females is also high is good. And so there are controls, which is sort of constant defense of the birch. And then the trees were then exposed to frass, to excrements of caterpillars. And that basically is a chemical signal that they are in the region, and therefore there is a danger of the tree being attacked. And then they were also exposed to manual defoliation. So basically you cut their leaves by scissors, and also to combination of both treatments. And you can see that they had a big effect and we've actually combined in many cases the combined one was more efficient than any one of these. And so there is a basically chemical signal, mechanical signal, and both of them. And so with induced defense, the caterpillars, when they were actually put on such treated plants, were doing much worse. And so you can see that this is sort of efficiency of induced defense. Of course, you can ask why all plants don't do that. Well, sometimes the induced defense can come late. You know, the attack can be such that if you are not a priori defended, then it might be too late for you. So, okay, sorry, this is a bit, okay. This is another interesting way of induced defense, and that is actually when, if the plant is eaten, then it can also release chemicals which signal to predators of these herbivorous insects, such as birds, that that plant is being eaten. And so it will attract these predators because they know that, you know, there is a lunch in the form of the herbivore on that plant. And so this is actually a mutualism between plants and predators, or also, also parasitoids. And it's based on the different types of signals, but for leaf chewing insects, there is a methylgeosmonate pathway. So methylgeosmonate can actually be artificially synthesized. And so if you spray plants with methylgeosmonate, as some research here with our colleagues, Elina Mantila and Katarzyna Sem and their student Anya Humlova did, then that actually increases the predation rate of caterpillars because it attracts both ants and birds to that plant. So we have done some experiments on the tropical trees, and you can monitor the predation rate either by live caterpillars put on the plant or by dummy caterpillars using the plasticine, and you can see that these are attempts to feed on them. So you can look at what is the number of attacked caterpillars. And so with methylgeosmonate, in this case, it was almost three times as high. It works also in the temperate zone. This was on the willows, and again, in this case, especially birds were responding again more than double the predation rate on the caterpillars. This kind of signaling actually can be quite widespread, and there has been since 1980s there were studies which gradually were adding different signaling, different uses of these plant signals. So, you know, plant, now we know that plants can signal to other plants and possibly inducing the defense in them, in predatory mites, parasitoid wasps, although this is actually surprising because when you think how parasitoids work, then they will attack the host, and then they will develop inside of that host, being careful not to kill it too fast. And so for the plant, if the predator comes and eats the herbivores, then, you know, it's the game over. But with parasitoids, I don't see how they can be very efficient in this. Their host will still be there and feeding on plant. But anyway, it's documented. Then predatory insects. Also, there can be signaling to other herbivores, which will be then avoiding these plants, because it's good to know that that plant has already been taken by other herbivores, and so you don't want to come into the situation where you are exposed to first competition for food, and second to plants which already had been induced in defense. And then there are also, you know, parasitic plants, nematodes, and predatory birds and pathogens. So the signaling goes on in different ways. This is another our study. This is from elevation gradient in New Guinea rainforest, where it was mechanical damage of plants. And again, when measuring predation, then the predation as such decreases. This is the predation rate, that's per caterpillar, and decreases with elevation, but also the effect of signaling. Yeah, there is the gap in the lowland forest, and then the effect of signaling is diminishing to high elevation. So when we sort of try to conceptualize this, whether it's better to have immobile defenses or mobile defenses, which of course mobile defenses are the only ones which can be induced. It doesn't really you know, do much good to try to induce immobile defenses. Then what we also have to consider is that mobile defenses have to be manufactured, you know, sort of constantly. They are short-living, while immobile, once you have cellulose or tannin, that is just sitting in your plant. Now, we also have to look at, you know, we already mentioned several times that plants are often fighting with other plants. And so we have to also think when the plant is making decision whether to get defended or not, it also depends on the context, whether what other plants are doing and how other plants of possibly different species can be affected by the existing herbivory. And so we can also approach this problem in a game theory framework, which I will try to briefly explain here. So let's look at defended plant. Yeah, and that defended plant can meet in the field, meet in the, you know, vegetation with either another individual which is defended or with individual which is non-defended. Okay, let's assume this is all one species. So we have the same parameters for these plants. And so what are the actually parameters we need to think about? So, well, whether to be defended or not, you have to consider what is the probability of being eaten, that means probability of herbivory, and how much damage it will do to you. So that means H times capital H, that's a fitness cost of herbivore damage. Okay, and then of course if you want to defend against that, then you have also cost of defense. All right, and then finally, if we are considering the competition between two plants, then if you know the other plant is being eaten, then you have to consider what good it will do to you. That means competitive benefit from the opponent being damaged by herbivores, and that also depends, of course, again on probability of herbivory. So, with these parameters in mind, okay, let's look at different scenarios. If defended plant is meeting another defended plant, then basically no herbivory is taking place, if we simplify it. So the small h is zero. So all these orange terms are zero. And so the only thing which is there is the cost of defense, because it's defended plant. Okay. If the defended plant is meeting non-defended plant, then it still has the cost of defense, but it has a benefits, competitive benefits of the opponent being eaten. So that's HB is positive and minus C it's a cost. So it's benefit and minus C is a cost. Okay, if we have a non-defended plant, then if it's meeting defended plant, then obviously it has no defense costs, but also it has no benefit of opponent being eaten, because opponent is defended, but it has another cost, and that is the cost to its fitness, because it's being eaten by herbivores. And if non-defended is eating non-defended, then no defense cost, but then both benefit of opponent being eaten and cost of the plant itself being eaten. Okay, so where all this leads? Well, if we want to determine what is the ideal proportion of defended and non-defended plants, then the strategy of defended plants should be equally beneficial as of non-defended plants. And that is of course possible, because these encounters depend on the frequencies. And so we can simply assume that the defended, you know, when we have a plant defended or non-defended, then it's either P as proportion of defended and one minus P is non-defended. And so if these terms are multiplied by the defended and non-defended probabilities, then So for instance, for defended plant, we have P times minus C, that's first term, plus 1 minus P times HB minus C, and that will equal the overall benefits of non-defended plant, which is again in this line. If you simplify this equation, then you will get basically that the balance of defended and non-defended plants depends on the probability of herbivory and fitness cost of herbivore damage. So you know, you can play this. That's basically going back to this chili and whether they are defended in the rain or not. So in this case, this is extension to competition between plants. Okay. I don't know how many of the people attending community ecology also attend the tropical ecology course. For those who do, then I apologize for occasional duplication. This is one of them. When we look at the plants and their defense, then we already mentioned that caffeine in coffee, which is shown here, if you didn't recognize it, is actually originally an anti-herbivore compound, and then of course it sort of got popular with people, and so it the coffee therefore captured an unexpectedly mutualistic relationship with humans as another vertebrate species, and you can see that you can wrongly see that coffee is a kind of serving people, it's exploited by people by you know, using it to drink coffee, but that would be biologically speaking completely wrong, because in fact what's happening is that the coffee is originally an understory shrub in an African tropical rainforest and competing against all these other plants there for light and nutrients in the soil. And so it managed to hijack brain of, chemically stimulate brain of another vertebrate species and make that species, you know, manipulate it. We have spoken last time about the parasite manipulation of host. This is exactly it. Basically, coffee is manipulating people into cutting down all these hundreds of competing species and promoting single one, which is coffee. And it's extremely successful strategy. So it's basically coffee can be seen as parasite on a human species, which is manipulating its host into behavior which brings no benefits to humans, but huge benefits to coffee. You can argue that coffee does bring benefits to you when you drink it. Well, again, in a purely evolutionary framework, that would have to result in coffee drinkers having higher fitness, which means higher reproduction than non-coffee drinkers. And I would say probably the opposite is true, because the most coffee is being drunk in temperate zone countries. The biggest consumption is Germany, Japan, other European countries, US. And in the tropics, it's only Brazil which is serious drinking coffee. Other countries don't. But of course, the number of children per person is following a completely opposite pattern, where especially low coffee drinking Africa has high reproduction and high drinking Europe has very low reproduction. So you can say that actually there is a negative correlation between coffee drinking and fitness. So this is clearly not a mutualistic relationship. Okay.
Professor, sorry.
Yes.
Can I have a question about yes. coffee. I'm just about the mutualistic relationship between among us and coffee, because can we say that we can create a sort of genetical drift because we grow monocultures of just a few species like Robusta and Arabica? And for sure, we spread the population in huge areas. but they are just few species. For sure, there are there is maybe a big genotype phenotypic variation, because the population is very spread, but there are very few species. So I'm asking if we can, if this relationship maybe is not completely mutualistic. Even you said for us it is not, it can be not, because coffee can be a parasite, if I understood well.
Yes, yes, we picked two species, Arabica and Robusta. So again, this is a common situation. Lots of crops have lots of relatives which are neglected. Yeah, so yes, this only benefits the few species we really pick. And you can actually argue that even within species, there are different varieties, and they also basically now compete for human attention. And so, for instance, with bananas, with all the varieties, we only use one, which is very uniform. And so even intraspecifically, you can argue that certain genotypes, basically won the jackpot with humans, and others are actually harmed by that. So yeah, like this is really extreme in bananas, where they are vegetatively propagated. You have no seeds in bananas in the cultivated in the Cavendish variety which we are using. So there is basically also huge expansion of a single genotype or genetic line at the expense of all other bananas from the same species, let alone other Musa species. The same goes with coffee, and the same goes with other crops. Yeah, and so this is happening on number of levels. Okay, so now another aspect of the defense against herbivores is what's happening within plant species. And there is a big distinction when it comes to leaves, and that is the young versus mature leaves. This is actually quite important. And in the tropics, you have the distinction which is highly visible. This is typical situation where you can see young leaves and old leaves, and these are like leaves from two different species. There is typically, I said that it might be difficult to be an apparent plant regarding the ability of herbivores to find it, but it's easier to be an apparent plant part. So the young leaves can be escaping the attention of herbivores by shortening the period of growth, trying to reduce the young leaf period at maximum shortage of time, and also being produced in different temporal and spatial patterns. This is not an option in temperate zone, where typically you have a leaf flush at spring, and so it's very predictable. It might be unpredictable when it actually starts, and that can cause problems, especially for insects which overwinter as pupae or eggs, and there has to be some kind of climatic triggers to tell the egg that it needs to emerge into a larva, and that has to be synchronized with the flush of young leaves. If it's too early or too late, then there is a problem. So there can be, even in temperate zone, there can be some tricks into how plants differently respond compared to herbivores to climatic signals for the leaf flush versus emergency of herbivores. But this is much more flexible in the tropics, where plants can actually, in many ecosystems, they can produce young leaves throughout the year, and so have flexibility of how and when to do it. why the young leaves? Okay, young leaves have a lot of physiological constraints which make them especially valuable to plants and at the same time especially attractive to herbivores. So that's why young leaves, it's a really sort of core of the herbivory. When you look at the young leaves, then they are expanding, and so they can't be protected by big molecules which are efficient against all herbivores, tannins, cellulose, and so on. By growing, they have to synthesize a lot of proteins. So that means, by definition, they have a high nitrogen content. They have high water content. They are soft. That's all features attractive to herbivores. At the same time, young leaves are sort of liability for the plant because they are their energetic budget is negative at the start. So that means plant has to use the resources to invest into the leaf to build it, and only later the leaf will repay that investment by photosynthesis. If the plant invests into the leaf and then the leaf is eaten before it can return the investment, then that's a problem for the plant. That's like if you take a loan, build a factory, and then factory is destroyed by fire, then the business is in problem, and that's exactly what is at stake here. So that's why the defense of young leaves is very different from that of the old leaves. So this is an example of a cherry tree, and then also of sorghum grass. Two trajectories in the water content and leaf nitrogen content as the leaves are maturing, starting from bud break here, and also the cyanogenic glycoside concentration. So that's like cyanide concentration here in ppm. So we are starting with high water content and high nitrogen content when at the bud break, which is good for herbivores, and also high cyanogenic glycoside content, which is of course defense and bad for herbivores, but not necessarily all of them. Some of them can be adapted to that. And then when you look at how the leaves are expanding, then over the time they are actually moving in this field towards low nitrogen content, low water content, and also low cyanogenic glycoside content, which you can see here coming from 2500 to 600 to 100 finally. Okay, exactly the same is happening for the sorghum. So this is a typical trajectory. When you look at Pteridium aquilinum, a common fern, also in Central Europe, in Czech Republic, this is a study from Great Britain. Then again, as the leaves are growing in spring, this is starting in May, high in cyanogenic glycosides, then it goes down. Pterosine is an alkaloid, again, a mobile defense, high and then goes down. Protein, high, goes down, and then quantitative defense, silicate and tannin, starting low and then going up. And then end activity, because it has nectaries, and so end activity high and then goes down again. So mobile defenses are high because the leaf is valuable to protect, and then they go down as the attractivity of leaf as expressed by the nitrogen goes down and the quantitative defense is built up. This is the budget, this is the energetic budget of a leaf population of a plant, and it's modeled under different types of mortality. Yeah, this is basically the abundance of the population of leaves of a given age under either no mortality, so then of course it's constant over time, or if the mortality rate, that means the probability of leaf dying within certain period of time, increases with age, which is sort of what you would expect, or if the probability of leaf dying per unit of time is constant, or if when it decreases with age. Yeah, and so these are the different developments, and then to them corresponds different energetic budget of that leaf population. So when the leaf starts growing, then no matter what happens, it's always coming to negative values of the carbon, because it's consuming more than producing. And then once if we have theoretically no mortality, then all the investment returns, you know, makes a huge returns in photosynthesis, and then the leaves, you know, finally the production goes down. If the mortality increases with age, there is already much smaller return. If constant, there is even smaller return. And then the worst, obviously, is that if young leaves are likely to die more than the old leaves, and then you can see that the area below the curve can actually be smaller than was the investment initially. So the whole exercise of growing leaves can be actually an energetic loss to the plant. And this is actually what will happen exactly to the leaves if herbivores are somehow not controlled, because then the younger the leaf, the more likelihood that it will be eaten by herbivores. One, it survives the young age, it's well defended by big molecules, and will survive more or less indefinitely. So, okay, we can return to that, but let's continue here. So there has to be some defense of the leaves. And again, even the young leaves have these two strategies. One can be secondary metabolites, but the small molecule ones, or another can be escape syndrome. And that in the case of leaves means trying to be rapid in expansion, and also having either synchrony, you can have leaf flush, which will overwhelm existing herbivores as long as it's unpredictable, or you can have also one leaf growing here, another there, and, you know, hoping that these distributed leaves, at least some of them, will escape. The way to speed up the leaf expansion is a typically tropical strategy, where the leaves are being expanded without chlorophyll and basically at a low nitrogen content. So they, even if they are young leaves, they are not really attractive, but then they expand, and then very quickly the plant will pump the chlorophyll there, and the leaf will toughen and will no longer be young. So this is one of the strategies, and this is again showing these different strategies for in this case different Inga species in the tropical forest. So you can have expansion rate and the chlorophyll in the leaf, and you can have, there is a negative correlation. So you can have either low chlorophyll, this is these white leaves, and the big expansion, fast expansion, so that's escape strategy, or you can have high chlorophyll, and that means low expansion rate, and that means there has to be some chemical defense. Also, the high expansion rate and the low chlorophyll also has a low nitrogen content compared to the equally fast expanding leaf with high chlorophyll. So these are two strategies of the leaves. And there is a very good reason for that, because these are tropical shrubs, and they were following the daily herbivory on the leaves, where zero here, the vertical line is when the leaf reaches the final leaf area. And so the expanding leaf is on the left, and then the maturing leaf is on the right. And you have herbivory damage here, and then also the toughness, nitrogen content, and chlorophyll content. And you can see that, of course, toughness is increasing at different rates as the leaves matures, then reaches some kind of final toughness. Nitrogen will be decreasing, especially, you know, changing when the leaf still grows. And chlorophyll will be increasing in different rates. But what is important here is the herbivory damage. And you can see that in some species, it's pretty much the only time in the lifespan of the leaf when there is any herbivory at all. When it gets beyond certain age, in this case, for instance, when it's more than 20 days old, then there is another 60 days of life, or in this case, there is another 40 days of life where basically leaf is completely safe already. So this is a really critical period. Okay, the same goes here in the next species. This is a bit more distributed. There is some herbivory going further down the line, but here again, a very, very clear peak. So basically all the damage we can see on these leaves happened when the leaf was young and was expanding. And then of course the holes in the leaves will stay for the lifetime of the leaf, but then there are of course species which don't have this kind of clear peak. That's example for the Ciliopia for this one. But this is a sort of general typical rule for especially tropical ecosystems. Okay, I think we have almost run out of time. So as expected, we will be continuing next time. Okay, we will continue with looking also at the impact of herbivores on plant competition. That is something which is shaping the lives of plants a lot. It's typically actually other plants which are the most serious enemy of a typical plant rather than herbivores. This case study from tropical forests is interesting because it looks at the different plant species which are specialized to different soils. There was a mosaic of clay soils and nutrient poor white sand soils, and each of these soils had a different plant composition. And so the researchers reciprocally transplanted plants from clay to either clay or white sand, and vice versa, white sand plants to again their original white sand soil and to clay soil. And then they introduce another treatment, and that is protecting plants from herbivores by placing them under a net or letting the herbivores access the plants. And so we have plants which are coming from clay in green here, and they are either in natural situation with access by herbivores or protected from them. And then there are originally white sand plants, and again transplanted to white sand or clay with either herbivores or without them. And when we look at the natural competitive situation of plants on different soils, when herbivores are not a factor, so that means protected from herbivores, then there was a paradox where when you look at the how the plants are growing, then the clay originated plants were doing vastly better on clay than white sand, which is not a big surprise. But then here you can see that they also were doing better on white sand. And so that raises questions why they actually don't colonize white sand and outcompete the white sand species, which would be suggested by if plant competition was the only factor. Only when they let insects come into the play, then everything returned to as you would expect. And that means that the clay originating plants were better doing on clay, but then they were doing really terribly on white sands. So it looks like it's actually insects which are keeping white sand plant species in the business. They are basically without their sort of protection, which in fact means that of course they are eating them, but they are eating the clay plants even more than that. And so without their protection, there would be only one plant community on the soil mosaic, not two different plant communities. Now, we can go one trophic level higher. We can also ask what is actually keeping insect herbivores under control in addition to defenses by plants. We have already mentioned the bottom-up plant resources and plant defense impacts on herbivores, but top-down impact of pathogens, parasites, and predators. So this is an example again from the tropics. What are the insect or generally arthropod densities of plants under different experimental scenarios, either with control or with yellow no birds or no birds and bats. And you know, for a long time, ornithologists were excluding birds by netting on plants, and that was seen as a reasonable experiment to look at their effect. And for quite some time, by being completely focused on birds, they actually appreciated very little that their nets actually remain in place overnight as well. And so they are actually preventing bats also from feeding on insects. And then once the studies started to separate it, which is actually quite labor intense, because you have to every morning, you have to either open or close nets and then do the same every evening. So some of plants will only be isolated from predators during the daytime, some of them overnight only. And then once you do that, then actually, at least in the tropics, you see that the importance of bats is about comparable to importance of birds. So once you have both excluded, then the predation rate indicates is comparable between birds and bats, so that insects almost have the same increment with excluding bats as with excluding birds, compared to control where they are under full predation. There is a number of experiments like that, fairly often with predictable results. This is another one, excluding lizards, which is much more difficult, again from Puerto Rico. Lizards are feeding on big insects, so there was an effect for that, while small insects not really. Then our colleague Katka Sem and her collaborators here in Papua New Guinea with Bonnie Koane, they were doing a similar caging experiment. Again, in this case, looking at the effect of excluding birds and bats on the density of insect herbivores from the lowland tropical forest all the way to alpine zone, 3,700 meters above sea level. And while there was always an effect, this is how many times more insect individuals were there in the under the cage compared to the control. And so when there are no predators around, no vertebrate predators around, then in the lowlands, insects will increase by 180%, and that effect is slowing down to 120% increase at the alpine zone. So, but there is a consistent indication that at least partly insect herbivores are controlled by their predators. That, of course, these controls, either plants by herbivores or herbivores by the natural enemies, opens consideration of biological control. And this has been, of course, debated and tried a number of times, herbivores on plants, or famous case of pathogens, myxomatosis on rabbits in Australia, and with a very variable degree of success. Basically, we are missing a biological theory which would allow us to predict the outcome. It's basically just, there are few rules. Of course, you want to introduce a specialized agent, a specialized herbivore, which will not affect other plants and will really focus on the alien species you want to get rid of. But apart from that, we don't really understand which species will be efficient and which not. And other than we just try and go and see what happens. This is example of an extremely successful experiment, or not really experiment, but action. This is Opuntia in Australia, where this neotropical cactus basically was foolishly introduced in Australia to plant fences for cattle. And of course, it got out of control and really caused a big problem initially. But then introducing a moth, Cactoblastis cactorum, went to almost immediate and perfect control, where since then, for many years already, there is a fairly balanced, low-level, low-density populations of Opuntia surviving and sustaining similarly low population of Cactoblastis. And there is a lot of much less successful or even unsuccessful introductions like this, and nobody really can explain what biological factors are responsible for the success here. Likewise, typically with alien plants, especially plants living in fresh waters can be a big problem, because in this case, Salvinia modesta, which is a floating fern, they can, when they get out of control, they can cover the entire surface of stagnant waters. And then when they die, they will decompose and exhaust oxygen from water. And so they can be a big nuisance in terms of chemistry of water, but also physically, you know, it's really hard to do anything in waters affected like that. And again, this was a neotropical species introduced to all other tropical areas. And by trying several species of native herbivores, the Sirtobagus salviniae, Curculionid beetle, proved to be efficient. And so there were hundreds of thousands or even millions breed it and you know, bred and then released to Africa and Pacific, and actually got at least for the time the Salvinia under control in many places. Okay, and now we are going to shift to community level. We have been looking at the herbivory and either the resources of herbivores or their enemies, focusing on individual species or populations. Now we will be looking on how the communities of herbivores are assembled together and how herbivores function in these communities. So first, we look at the plant community, which typically represents the range of possible host plants for any herbivore. And we can ask whether, you know, how good are herbivores in selecting their host plants and using them. You know, is that optimum selection, or are they making mistakes? So this is a study of swallowtail butterfly, Papilio macaon, looking at the meadow ecosystems with all these potential hosts, plant species, and then they were looking at how the females were selecting plants for oviposition, and then how the larvae, the caterpillars, actually were doing, surviving on the host plants they hatched on and they were feeding on. And so you can see that, of course, the species which will make a huge number of mistakes and fails to completely recognize suitable host plants, of course, that's not evolutionary sustainable position. But so there is no surprise that the most preferred plant species are also those where caterpillars are doing well. But interestingly, there are some quite serious mistakes. You see that the fourth most used plant species actually had a zero survival of larvae. So that was clearly a mistake. And then also, there is another large mistake, Levisticum officinale. And while, again, these are Daucaceae, these are the family where the Papilio is feeding on. And so the favorite one is Peuceranum palustre. This is all European floras. So that's the most favorite one. Then there are a few others which are good to different degree. And again, even equally successful plants are used to a different degree. And then there are also plants which would be perfect food source, including Pastinaca sativa, for instance, and are not used at all. So you can say these might be mistakes going in opposite direction. So that means a suitable food resource which is neglected. Of course, this is only larval survival in terms of plant chemistry. There can be complicating factors, for instance, parasitism rate, predation rate, which actually would make these seemingly good plants unfavorable. But that's another question. When we consider herbivory, there is a huge range of host specialization, from strictly monophagy species feeding on one plant species, all the way to those feeding on thousands of species even, and that can be both vertebrates and some of the insects. And so we have a task of explaining why are there host specialized herbivores, and also why are there generalists, what are the pros and cons, advantages and disadvantages for these different strategies. And so we can briefly look at the list, and then we can go having a closer look at some of them. So first, there can be a trade-offs in performance between host species. So basically, this is saying that a specialized herbivore will be doing better on its one host plant selected than the competing herbivore, which is not specialized like that and which has a wide range of plant species, because simply it can't specialize well enough for each of them. Then there can be interspecific competition. If a certain population of herbivores is only feeding on one plant species, it may get overcrowded there, and so it may be actually profitable to have a wider range of plants. And even if you don't do too well on a secondary host, it may still be better to go there if the primary host, the most profitable one, is too overcrowded. There is the question whether generalist predators can be less efficient on hunting specialized herbivores, because they can better avoid detection, hide on the host plant, or sequester the specific chemicals, as we have seen last time, for the defense. And there can be also similarity of some hosts to unsuitable hosts. So there can be these mistakes we have seen in actually locating hosts. Specialized host can be also not a feeding address only, but also generally suitable address for finding mates. So it can be useful to be specialized on a single one. I already mentioned sequestering metabolites, and also, as we have seen, for instance, in Central Europe with bark beetles, if you are specialized and your whole population aggregates on the plant, then it can overwhelm plant defenses, exactly as bark beetles, some of them are doing. So these are the good reasons to be specialized, but then, of course, there are also good reasons to be generalist. First, you have a wider range of plant species you can feed on. And so if any individual host becomes rare or is unpredictable, unapparent, then you may be in troubles unless you have alternative hosts. If the plants are too small and larvae, for instance, have to move, because it finished entire plant where it hatched out, then it might be profitable not having to find one specific plant which might be far away. Also, the hosts not only can change in abundance, but also in host quality. There is also we already mentioned the competition, and also predator and pathogen functional numerical response. If predators or pathogens are really focused on finding herbivores feeding on certain plant species, using, for instance, plant chemistry as signals, as we have also discussed, then it might be actually a very good idea to also be on a less typical secondary host. So when we look just a little sort of clarification on charts of some of these genetically based trade-offs, it looks like this. We have host A in orange, if only feeds on one plant, has higher fitness on that plant than if it has to specialize at two plants at the same time, where on every single plant, the fitness is lower than if it were specialized. And then other host B in blue may have the same may have the same problems, but in this type, in this time, specialized on a different plant species. And again, if it's not strictly specialized, it has a wider range, then fitness even on that one plant species, the same plant species, will go down. Okay. We can have interspecific competition. So you can have a host where the given herbivore has fitness the same on different plant species when there is no competition. But if there are other species present, then suddenly there could be diminished fitness because of its poor competitive ability. And so in that case, suddenly if you only were specialized on the plant B, then it's less favorable than if you have A plus B, because if you find yourself competing on one plant, can be good to good to move on the on the other plant. But it can work also in opposite way, in favor of specialization. So basically, you can have, it depends on what is the temporal variability of these competitive situations. If this is a permanent situation where you always have to compete with certain competitors on B and C, that can actually lead to strict specialization on A. So even if in the laboratory, physiologically, you would perform equally well on all three plant species, then in the field, if you are faced with competition, there can be sort of a competition-free space on A, and that can lead to specialization. So you can use this competition as argument for either being specialized or being generalist, depending on the particular dynamics of the system. I also mentioned the generalist predators. They actually been shown to be less efficient finding and predating specialized herbivores. So if they are only feeding on one plant, they are more successful in avoiding parasitoids or predators than if they are more generalist, even on the same plant. So again, that can lead to specialization. And then of course, if different plant species are variable in time, then you can always get sufficient resource base if you are more generalist. That makes sense. Now for the generalists, intraspecific competition. Previously we were discussing interspecific ones. So that means if there is a different species competing with you and causing your lower fitness on certain plant species. In this case, however, there can be also the effect of density of its own species, of its own population. And decrease in fitness, of course, on different plant species. These different colors, that's host plants A, B, C. And for each of them, we can see some kind of arbitrary abundance increase for the herbivore. And as you can expect, the fitness will be declining with increasing abundance, but it can be declining at different rates. So if there is a low population density, obviously orange plant species A is the best choice. But then at higher population densities, it can actually be the worst choice. And so there is no stable ranking of what is the optimum choice. And so being flexible, being generalist can be advantageous. So for instance, when you look at optimum distribution of population at the abundance level 2, then the best thing would be if you have one individual on orange one and then one individual on either orange or blue one, so that the combined fitness will be 10 plus 7. If you have both of them, if it's a specialist on orange one, which is most profitable at low densities, then suddenly if you have to go to population density 2, then the combined fitness of these two individuals will be only 14. So that's less optimum. And of course, you can look at all kinds of distribution scenarios. If you have a population density 3, that would be clearly very unsuitable to be all of them, all three individuals on orange. So it would be best if you had two individuals on orange. First one will be at 10, second one will be at 7, and then one on the blue again at 7. One and blue, so that will be at 8. And so you can distribute plants like that in this kind of exercises. Now, when we're talking about specificity, just a note, we can talk about host specificity, how many plant species we have, but we can also look at how they are related and look at what is the phylogenetic specialization. You can have a lot of plant species, but all of them related. And so that is, of course, lower specialization phylogenetically than if you have the same number of plant species distributed across phylogeny. And then there is also ontogenic specificity. Lots of insects, for instance, can have completely different host plants when they are larvae than when they are adults. And then within plants, there can be also very narrow specialization to certain plant parts. And again, you can have, for instance, there can be mining herbivores feeding on the upper side of the leaf only, and others feeding only on the underside of the leaf. Most of the insects are specialized to young leaves, but not necessarily all of them. Then you have, of course, flower feeders and so on and so on. So you can have also high structural specificity, and then the specialization can also change with different locations. So you have geographic signal in between populations, how they are specialized. Now, when we look at the overall trends in specialization, then for insects, you can say with some kind of generalization that that insects tend to be narrowly specialized. These are some of the more extreme examples. That's a community from Great Britain, leafhoppers, and this is how each species is, how many plants they have as hosts. So there are some generalists in every taxon, but the dominant numbers are fairly specialized. Leaf miners are more extreme in that. They are known for being very, very specialized. So of course you will get slightly different results in some other taxa, but overall there is a tendency to specialization, which leads to an interesting question: what happens for alien plants, which we already mentioned? They can brought somehow by chance their own herbivores from the original country when they come from with them, but most often they are a new, sometimes interesting target for the local herbivorous communities. And so it's actually an interesting study ecologically to see what kind of herbivores they will acquire. So this is an example of Citizus coparius, which is a shrub also growing in Central Europe. It's Fabaceae, and there are some characteristics of phytophagous communities when the plant is native. This is England and France, and introduced New Zealand and Australia. And so, as you can expect, the number of herbivorous species are lower in the new areas, but not zero. So they do attract local fauna, and then they are mostly generalist, again, as you could expect. So there are very few or even no specialists, while generalists are actually higher in the number of species than for the native in the native region. And then also when you look at the abundance of specialists, even when they are there, then they can be much rarer, while generalists don't show such a pattern. Now, since we are talking about herbivores being very diverse and representing a big part of the general biodiversity, we can look at what are the mechanisms of the generating diversity of herbivores. That of course can apply also to any other two trophic levels. When we are talking about this, we can equally well talk about hosts and parasitoids or pathogens or even predators, although there will be some differences because predators tend to be less specialized. So this is a comparison between temperate zone and the tropics, trying to explain why there are more herbivorous species in the tropics, but can be applied generally looking at the ways of generating higher diversity in place B than in place A. So one very trivial example will be more plant species. If you have more plant species, you would expect all other things being the same, you can expect more herbivorous species. So you have the original situation, three plants and then herbivores, seven herbivore species with some overlap. Some of them are specialized, some of them not. And then if you add two more plants, then with the same pattern of partial specialization, you will get three more species. So that's obviously, when we are talking about temperate zone tropical comparisons, that's obviously part of the picture that's definitely happening. Then you can also have more insects per plant. That's what we saw when we compare native and introduced range of the same plant, but also it can be between plant species. Again, starting point is the same. And then here the plants are the same, but each of them has extra insect species. And then you can have higher specialization. So you can see here that not only the plant species are the same, but also number of herbivores feeding on every plant is exactly the same, but they are more specialized. And so for reaching the same number of herbivorous species per plant, you need to get more herbivorous species. And that's exactly what you see here. And finally, as we mentioned, there can be geographic element where the same plant species can have different herbivorous faunas in different geographic regions. Now, talking about these tropical temperate differences, and that's actually something which can provide insights into ecology of herbivores. There is a lot of more plant species in the tropics, that's clear, but then the question is whether the insects feeding on them, and there are obviously more insect species in the tropics as well, herbivorous and plants, whether they are more specialized or less. And so this is example of one large study where we also participated with our team, and this is for caterpillars. So again, this is the number of families different species are feeding on, and you can see that there is quite large number of insect species involved, and typically it's one plant family, and then there is some long tail of extremely generalist species, some of them feeding off up to 37 different plant families. So again, being extreme generalist, even in insects, let alone in herbivores, is possible physiologically and ecologically. But interesting question is, why is it not being used more often? And so that's something we have to consider. And when we look at the specialization index for Lepidoptera, then basically the highest specialization is in the equatorial zone and then is diminishing with latitude. When we look at pairwise comparison between tropical and temperate zone for different guilds of herbivores, different groups, miners, sepsucking insects, leaf chewing larvae, wood boring insects, and then insects sucking on phloem and also adult leaf chewers, then in most comparisons there is a higher specialization in the tropics. But there is a complication to that picture, which we found by comparing Central European and New Guinea communities. we also have to think that the tropical plant communities are not only more species diverse, but also phylogenetically more diverse. They recruit from a larger number of families. And so when we are looking at the specialization of insects, then it's always compared with the existing range of plants there. And so it can be affected by the diversity of the local community. So what we did is that we basically looked at the temperate zone floodplain forest in Moravia and sampled herbivorous insects from all the main trees which are there. I'm sure you recognize the species. And then we used our data from New Guinea and we selected species so that they are mirroring the phylogeny of the temperate zone sample. So when you look at the phylogenetic relationships, they are basically pretty much identical. So in this way, we standardize the plant phylogeny, not only number of plant species. And then when you count hosts, you have no difference. So yes, there are insects are more specialized in the tropics, but it's mostly driven by the phylogeny and diversity of plant communities. At least in this case, there can be, again, huge variety in different systems. This is a nice study, which is comparing oaks, Quercus, and this is one of the few genera which is growing in the tropics as well as in sort of subtropical California. And so they were looking at different species and also Curculio, curculionid beetle feeding on the oaks. And so this was a very, very nicely done system. As you can see that the tropical species are not identified while Californian ones are. There are a reasonably comparable number of oaks between two systems. There are still more species in the tropics. And when you look at the specialization, then the host range in California was much wider than in the neotropics, in the tropical one in Nicaragua. And so in this case, there was genuinely, in again, a very standardized way, there was a higher specialization in the tropics. Now we can look at the temperate tropical contrast also from different ways. We can look at not only phylogenetical diversity and number of plant species differs, but also we can ask whether the defense is more intense in the tropics. And it can be for a number of reasons. It can be a higher pressure by herbivores, or it can be that defenses are cheaper. And so, you know, you can manufacture more in the tropics, or it can be also simply that with the higher phylogenetical diversity, then you get a higher diversity of defenses, but on a per plant basis, there might not be much difference. So there has been a study which was looking at the levels, again, different chemistry, was looking at the levels of defenses for number of oak species, again distributed from temperate to tropical locations, and then they were correlating them with the climatic variables for places where they were living. So not only dividing them to temperate and tropical, but actually looking at rainfall, temperature, solar radiation, and so on. And they actually extracted a tropical temperate axis of variability when you do multivariate analysis of these two data sets. So there is a tropical temperate zone axis, and there is a correlation for the defensiveness index. It's basically, again, multivariate measure of how leaves of oaks are defended. And so in this case, the tropical systems are more defended from herbivores than in temperate zone. Now we have talked mostly about insects, but of course there are vertebrate herbivores as an important part of the ecosystems. As well, they are typically more generalist. You know, the herbivores which are specialized, like panda, are getting famous for that. So that already tells you that others are sort of fairly generalist grazers typically, but still, none of the herbivores is true generalist, not really caring what they eat. That's why when you look at pastures, then you can see that there are plants which are strictly avoided. And also everybody knows in the sort of agriculture business that grazing by goats or sheep or cattle provide very different selection pressures and very different results in terms of final composition of the vegetation. You can look at these choices basically as either minimizing time, so that means selecting plants which will give you the highest nutrition input per time unit, or maximizing energy. So that means that the most energetically profitable plants are selected, even if it takes a longer time to locate them and eat on them. And so this is an example of a model where this is the diet predicting certain percentage of monocots in the diet based on these constraints of optimizing energy or optimizing time. And in this particular case, it looks like the energy was optimized, but that can't be general rule. Sometimes when you have, for instance, high predation pressure, minimizing time can be actually a good strategy. Okay, now we will be looking at the composition of the communities. There is a sort of classical study on Pteridium aquilinum bracken, which in Czech is Hasivka orličí. It's a fern which is commonly found in the forest understories and also open places in Europe. That study was done by John Lawton in the UK and his team, and I have a particular fondness for that also because my first overseas postdoc was in Great Britain, and it was a Royal Society Fellowship which was sponsored by John Lawton. And so this study actually selected bracken because it's one of the few plants which is naturally distributed on all continents. Ferns tend to have wide distribution ranges because their spores can be easily transported by wind, but still, even as ferns go, Pteridium aquilinum is a bit of an exception. And so it provides an excellent opportunity to look at the structure of communities at different geographic regions and look for ecological constants. Of course, the species will be different, but we can look, for instance, at the number of species feeding on ferns. And as you can see here, it has a strong connection to the area of the bracken growth. Again, it often is forming monospecific growth, so it's fairly easy to measure the area. And again, there is a reasonable correlation, although we would like to have more points there, of course. This doesn't really necessarily work when we look at the local community diversity. So this is, this is the regional diversity, which is here on the left. And but then when you look at local communities, then there you can have a high regional diversity and still locally poor communities, for instance, or vice versa. But more interesting is when you look at the niche structure of the communities, you can simply divide communities by where on plants the herbivores are feeding, and so you have this basic simple division to rachi, spina, and midribs on the fern. And then what's the way of utilizing this resource? And again, very simple is distinctions are chewing insects, sepsucking, mining, and gallers. And here, when you look at different community structure, every point is one species. If it feeds on more than one plant part, then the two points are connected. And you can say that, okay, if the communities are somehow constructed in a sensible functional way, then we would expect convergence across continents. Not perfect one, of course, sometimes the regional species pools may be missing a suitable species, but we would expect some degree of convergence. And we know that convergent evolution of morphological or chemical features is very common, that basically the same adaptations are discovered again and again throughout evolution. Is that happening for construction of communities when we have independent attempts at different continents? And the answer is no. You can see by sort of just looking at these diagrams that everyone is different from the others. So for instance, we have the New Guinea situation demonstrates that there can be quite a few species sepsucking on pinna. So we have four here, and there are even more in Australia, but there is nothing in Brazil. So, you know, presumably that niche is viable. You can have herbivores sucking on pinna, but it's not, there is unoccupied niche, and you can find lots of examples here. Also, in the UK, you have a lot of chewers on pinna, 10 species. Some other communities have very few. So there is no convergence on that level. When you look at the taxonomic convergence, again, there is none. These are herbivores which are classified by individual orders of insects. And again, we don't really have to look at on the details, but they are all ordered in the same way. And so visually, you would expect the same shape of each graph, and that's far from it. You know, you have a lot of beetles in New Guinea, and you have no beetles in US and also in the UK. But then again, you have some beetles in Brazil and South Africa, and so on and so on. You can find that, you know, the most dominant order are Diptera in the UK, Lepidoptera in South Africa and Brazil, Homoptera in Australia, and Coleoptera in New Guinea. So, you know, everywhere it's different. When we go one taxonomic level low, when we look at Lepidoptera, then on the level of families, again, you don't see any consistency. The Great Britain is dominated by noctuids, while in Africa we have noctuids at the same level as arctids, and so on. This is another study which is basically showing the same point. This is Lepidium draba. That's an Eastern European plant species, including Czech Republic, and then it expanded recently to Western Europe. And then it was introduced to United States as an alien plant species. And again, you have the same distinction here, different plant parts and different mode of feeding. And again, there is actually some consistency between Eastern and Western Europe, which sometimes is simply the same insect species expanding together with the plant. But then there is much less consistency with United States. When we look at the specific species, then just look at the most common ones. So in Eastern Europe, it's the Fripp, Francinella occidentalis, and beetles and beetle Colaphellus sophiae. And the same two species are also dominating Western European community, while when we look at the United States, then interestingly, the thrip made it to United States as well, and it's actually maintaining its dominance there. It's winning over all other species, but then there are there is mite Bryobia pratisea, and then a bug Liguus elisus, which are new colonizers reaching the highest abundance. So when we look at different host specialization, as you can expect, the US are really dominated by polyphagy species, unlike the Eastern and Western Europe, which still have a lot of polyphagy species, but they also have monophages and oligophages. On another level of consistency, we can also look at different taxa for herbivorous communities colonizing different host plant species. So this is the relative composition of herbivorous communities on trees in Great Britain. And it's not on the level of species, but on the level of insect orders or other higher taxa. And you can have a look at beetles and aphids, which are highlighted in green and red. And again, it's in the same place, but different host tree species. And again, just looking at it, there is no convergence in the relative taxonomic abundance. And it also goes to modes of feeding. Aphids are phloem feeders. And again, you can see that there are very different. Quercus ilex is entirely consisting from aphids and microlepidoptera, while other species can be dominated by coleoptera and so on and so on. These are our studies from Papua New Guinea, showing also that different guilds, just to repeat, guild is a group of species using the same resource in the same way. So the classification of guilds is flexible. You can have guilds looking at simple distinction, whether they are using leaves or fruits of the plant or roots or stems. But then people studying fruits tend to distinguish whether it's eating on the fleshy part or whether it's eating on the seeds. If you go to more details, some people will distinguish the way it's that resource is used, whether it's pre-dispersal when the fruit is still on the plant, or post-dispersal when it already been dispersed, then it's attacked and so on. So there is no taxonomy of gills which everybody would observe. There are some sensible approaches, and so some are the basic plant parts and the way how they are used, which can be chewers. Basically, herbivore is on the surface of the plant, or it's a vertebrate herbivore and feeding from outside. Then you have miners, which are feeding inside of the leaf or flower, and then you have sap-sucking insects, which are just piercing the plant and sucking either from phloem or from xylem. These are two very different sources, if you remember. And then you can have these chewers and suckers. You can have it on fruit, on roots, and then you can have gallers, which are manipulating plants into creating galls. And then you can also have herbivores, which are not strictly herbivores, but they are fungivores. They are infecting plants with fungi and then feeding on these fungi. So you can have all these gills. And then here, these are the same three species on this food web at the bottom. And these are the species of different gills. It's all coming from the same tropical rainforest in New Guinea. And so again, just visually, not only that different gills, of course, have different number of species, adult leaf chewers, which includes grasshoppers, stick insects, and beetles, are very, very, very species diverse. Unlike, for instance, more specialized leaf miners here, but more importantly, there is also very different degree of specialization. So you can have adult chewers, which are fairly generalist. You see a lot of connections, and then you have gaulers here, where pretty much each of them is only feeding on one plant species. And then you have all kinds of transitions in between. So this is a bit problematic for ecologists, because of course, ecologists have their favorite groups. And so when you look at the data we have, then the caterpillars are very popular, miners as well, but very few people will actually study insects chewing on roots for obvious reasons. Because these guilds are each very different in terms of specialization, then it's really hard to generalize from studying a single one. Interestingly, when you look at this graph, then we can actually derive this kind of statistics that the guilds which have a high number of herbivores per plant species tend to be generalists, and the guilds which have a small number of herbivores per plant species tend to be specialized. So this is the graph showing that, and it's entirely derived from this picture. So for instance, as I mentioned, you have adult leaf chewers, lots of species, generalists. Larval leaf chewers, fewer species, but still a lot, and a reasonable degree of generalism. Leaf miners, much more specialized, and you see fewer species. Sap-sucking insect, leaf suckers, even fewer, and all are monophages. Gaulers, relatively few, all monophages, and so on and so on. So this is actually counterintuitive. Yeah, you would expect that if the species are specialized and each herbivore feed only on one plant species, you would expect that they will find a way to coexist on a plant species much easier than if you have these generalists which will just go on the plant and feed sort of indiscriminately without fine adaptation to that plant. But actually the opposite is true. This is island biogeography, looking at the diversity of fauna on different islands, which is defined by the rate of immigration to the islands and species extinction from the islands. And it depends, these rates are depending on how isolated is the island and how large is the island. Why am I mentioning that here? Well, it's because the individual host plants can be actually considered ecologically as a distinct habitat islands, as distinct resource islands. And so we can use these predictions to look at what's happening to the herbivorous communities on them. This island biogeography theory was proposed by MacArthur and Wilson. It's E.O. Wilson, still alive and famous, and but this was way back. It was in 1970, and so they not only proposed this theory, but also Wilson, being the field person, he immediately embarked on empirical tests of it. And so he had a PhD student, Dan Simberlov, who is still fairly prominent and active scientist. And so it was his PhD thesis to actually look at some experimental verification. And they actually happened to use the system which works as an island. It was a mangrove island, which is very simple because it has no soil. You can see that the roots are basically sticking out of the sea, off the coast of Florida. It actually works also for our purpose of looking at the habitat islands represented by plant species, because that mangrove was mostly constructed by a single mangrove species. And so they defaunated the island. They basically killed everything which was living on that island by fumigating it with poisonous gas, and a nice experiment. And then they were looking how it was recolonized, and yes, the more isolated island was recolonized slower, and then the island near the the mainland was actually recolonized pretty much back to the original number of species. They also experimentally manipulated the size of the islands by basically destroying part of the island, cutting them off, and they found that that actually led to decrease in number of species. So we can apply all these rules on the herbivorous communities on individual plants. We can also look at, you know, when we are considering these communities, we can also look at some interface between ecological rules, how many species can coexist locally, and the phylogenetical dynamics. And that applies to the regional species pool. You know, some lineages can have very fast speciation for whatever reasons, and then the local communities can be either sort of proportional subsets of these regional pools. And in that case, the bigger regional pool you have, the higher local diversity you have in the communities, or you can have some upper limit of how many species can locally coexist, and that will lead to a saturation like you see in the type 2, where you can't really go, even if you have more regionally available species, you can't go above certain diversity. Of course, different communities can behave differently. These are the goal-making herbivores in England, which follow basically the proportional situation. And then these are end species, not exactly herbivores, all of them, but showing indications of saturation, which sort of makes sense because ants are more competitive. Okay, these are some, again, application of the concept of habitat island. There are two different approaches. The top two graphs are monospecific stand of certain plant species, which are actually crops, and in different geographical regions, and looking how many pest species they accumulate on them. So these are different regions, different countries growing cocoa, and how many pests are there, and you can see that there is a good correlation. The same goes for sugarcane, and that actually the crosses are the places where sugarcane is native, and the other markers are where it's not, and it doesn't make much difference. The two graphs below are different type. There, each point is different host plant species, and they are from the same region. So we have oak species in California. Each of them is shown as a point here. And it's the geographic region of each species and how many herbivorous species they have. And again, the more widespread species, the more herbivorous species it accumulates. The same goes for leafhoppers on trees in Great Britain, although there the correlation is much less convincing than for the oaks. And finally, I would conclude this ecological part by also noting that what we have discussed is the result of long evolution between plants and herbivores, but there can also be some very fast movement in this situation, and we can experimentally actually create some evolutionary scenarios and already see a response of certain populations. This is an example of a very interesting study by Anurag Agrawal, who is a very prominent researcher in this field, and looking at Enotera biennis, which I think in Czech is called pupalka, and then they were having plots with controls, sort of natural situation, and then they had plots where they excluded insects, so by spraying with insecticide. And importantly, they maintained that experiment for 5 years, which is not really a long period of time, but you know, at least it provides some kind of scope for the populations of plants to change, and they actually found fairly quick response. First, the plants who were permanently living without fear of insects, because there were no insects allowed, then they actually grew they actually grew less resistant to insects. When you expose them to seed eaters, then they become less defended and therefore less resistant compared to the control. Further, they also become when they didn't have to worry about insects, they clearly invested their energy elsewhere and they became better competitors with other plants. They tested it in experiments with Taraxacum officinalis, and the higher competitiveness is actually at the lower part of the graph. And so the plants without insects after 5 years were better competitors in experiments than those which were in the control. Now, when they were looking at the chemical defenses, there is a specific tannin protecting fruits and leaves of this plant. And for the leaves, they did not find any difference between insect-free and control populations, but they did find a difference in the seeds. And as you can expect, the defense in insect-free populations decreased. And so when they were exposed to actual insects, then those from control still had a positive correlation between how well they were defended and how many seeds they were able to produce. But that did not work like that in the insect suppress region, because the success was mostly defined by insect predation in response to the degree of defense, and the insects were simply not present in the blue experiment. And so they found that actually the lifetime fitness, that means production of seeds, was higher, not surprisingly, for the situation where there were no insects. But the main mechanisms was that there was early flowering. So the plants which did not have to invest into insect defense, they flowered earlier, and that leads to bigger seed production than those who had to fight insects all the way.